Before we begin, three messages. If you're a freelancer or running your own small business, the one thing you probably wish you could do quicker and easier is invoicing. That's where FreshBooks.com comes in. They take the pain out of invoicing and get you paid faster. Effortlessly create invoices and email them to your clients. They can view them, print them, and even pay you right away with PayPal or any of their 11 other payment gateways. FreshBooks.com can automate late payment reminders and help track your billable hours at the office or while on the go with their apps for iPhone, BlackBerry, and Android. I'm only one of over 2 million really, really, really satisfied customers, and you can be one as well, all for free. Just head to www.freshbooks.com and sign up. When you do, be sure to say you heard of them from untether.tv, and one of you, my loyal, loyal, loyal viewers, will win a birthday cake each and every week. Doesn't even have to be your birthday. Get started today for free at www.freshbooks.com. When my company needed to develop a key mobile product, one that I was counting on as a new source of revenue, I knew exactly who to turn to. Macadamian. They delivered on time, with incredible attention to detail, and I was able to get product into customers' hands faster than I ever thought possible. I've personally known them for 10 years, and they do make great products even better. Check them out at www.macadamian.com. Here's a riddle. How do you build native cross-platform mobile applications quickly without having to rewrite code and hire consultants at a huge cost? Titanium from AppCelerator. Called the easy button for mobile application development, it allows you to focus more on what's important, getting product out the door. Join the more than 1.5 million active developers who have created over 13,000 apps at www.appcelerator.com. Hello, everybody. My name is Rob Woodbridge, and this is untethered.tv, where we sit down and have casual conversations with mobile rock stars. I've got another one. Of course, every day I bring you a mobile rock star. And this one, John, I'll give you a name, is from the great city of New York. He works for a great company called DailyGrape, which is actually, as you know, probably by this point, it is the hosted television show or web TV show and now mobile television show that stars Gary Vaynerchuk, obviously author and accomplished social media guru and the thank you author of the Thank You Economy. What I hope to get out of this entire session here is how leveraging an audience, a basic tenet of mobile is leveraging an existing audience from the real world and bringing them into this space. It's something that people have done very effectively, and I see Gary has done it very effectively, and I'd like to introduce you to Jon Troutman, who is the Director of Operations for the DailyGrape. Jon, thanks, man. Thanks for doing this.
Rob, thanks so much for inviting me on the show, and I'll say this, that's probably the first and only time I'll ever be introduced as a rock star.
I love it.
So thank you.
It's a common response. I'm not a rock star. Well, you can be, right? Depends on... I think people will reserve judgment at the end of this. They'll decide whether or not you're a rock star. I don't let them vote, but you're a de facto rock star. You go into the Rockstar Hall of Fame for mobile.
I'm taking that title and running with it.
So. I would definitely do it. I feel like I have to have I gotta have a nickname for the show, like the Mobile Thunder Show or something, and I gotta stomp up and down or have a spit bucket next to me as I'm going through this. So thanks for doing this. I really appreciate it. I've spoken with Sam Taggart a couple of times. You guys are in the VaynerMedia, and what Gary's doing with Wine Library TV and DailyGrape are kind of at the forefront of all of this kind of technology. And we're not here to talk about technology, but it leverages every aspect of technology, and especially in the mobile space. Really thrilled that that the Daily Grape is now a mobile application, and I want to hear a little bit more about it. But we're going to start at the very beginning.
Sure.
Daily Grape, what is it?
Daily Grape, good question. So essentially, you know, Wine Library TV was Gary's daily internet wine show for wine for 5 years. He started a little over 5 years ago at this point. Built up an immense following, really by engaging with this community and offering up free wine content on a daily basis in an approachable, kind of fun way, which,
yes.
I mean, wine is, it hasn't been fun up until a few years ago, and really that's been Gary's goal, to make it fun. With Daily Grape, it's essentially, which we launched at South by Southwest this past year, just a little over a month ago. It's a rebranding and a continuation of Gary's Daily Wine Show, this time in mobile form in addition to a web-based app.
Yeah, shorter episodes, right? That's what we were talking about before.
Exactly. Whereas, you know, Wine Library TV would often go up into the half hour, 40 minute time frame. And as much as Gary likes to rant, we definitely see mobile as being kind of the way of the future. And 40 minute episodes are not mobile friendly. So all of our episodes at this point are really 5 to 10 minutes, jam packed with that same wine content, just kind of condensed down in a shorter form.
And, you know, I'm not a wine drinker, nor do I really care about wine, but I've watched all 18 episodes of Daily Grape, and I was an avid watcher of certainly Wine Library TV for some reason, and it's probably Gary, because he says things like, you know, with a hint of pencil shavings, right, when he's sniffing the wine. I'm like, well, okay, I mean, I can understand that. It's like Wine Library, it's wine tasting for dummies like me.
Exactly. And I mean, that's definitely where Gary stands out from the rest of his peers in terms of, you know, wine reviews and breaking down wine, and that people can identify with, you know, what their eraser tasted like when they would chew on their pencil in middle school. And they can identify with pencil shavings, and they can identify with, you know, the smell of a rubber ball.
Yeah.
Whereas you start talking about things like cassis and pomegranate and quince and all these other things, it might not really make sense. So we want to make it fun. We want to make it understandable. And at the end of the day, it's a fermented, you know, grape juice. It's nothing that people should be intimidated by, like they have been for hundreds of years. So,
well, I have the distinct name. My name is Robert Woodbridge. So for quite some time, I mean, we served Robert Mondavi wine from Woodbridge, California, at our, and that was the, you know, I felt very privileged to have the same name. Although I'm not getting any royalties from it, I should trademark something. let me ask you this: why mobile? You know, Gary had winelibrary.tv, which was a very successful. He did 1,000 episodes on television, which on Wine Library TV, which is pretty amazing. Seems to, you know, be rolling, has a great following. What was it that really brought this into mobile? Why mobile?
You know, it's really, at the end of the day, the single thing that drove us to make Daily Grape and to make it a mobile-based app is innovation. I mean, with VaynerMedia that you mentioned earlier, Gary's kind of social media brand consulting agency, you know, they consult with a bunch of Fortune 500 brands. We're talking about, you know, Campbell Soup and PepsiCo. And he would go into the boardroom with these executives and bark at them about the fact that they need to be leveraging things like Foursquare, Gowalla, and all these other mobile applications. And then I think one day he really looked at himself in the mirror and realized, I'm telling them to do this, and yet I have my own product here, Wine Library TV, and it's not mobile friendly.
Right.
So really, innovation. I think everything is going mobile, but when you talk about something like wine, you know, people buy wine at a point of purchase type of thing.
Yep.
You know, you go into a restaurant, you're presented a wine list. You walk through a wine shop, and you're overwhelmed with, you know, a massive amount of wine bottles staring you in the face. You can't pull up your laptop and pull up Wine Library TV, whereas you can pull out your iPhone or soon your Android device, flip open a quick app and get either a 5-minute episode, flip through it really quick, or a database of wines,
right,
and kind of give you an idea of what you might want. So it was really just the natural progression.
Absolutely makes sense. And I recall something along the lines, maybe it was 3, 4, 5, 6 months ago or something to that effect, and it might have been a live broadcast on Ustream, where somebody asked that question. So why don't you have an app? Why can't I take Gary with me and help him choose my wines in the store or make recommendations based on, you know, what I'm eating, and have it, you know, based on the winelibrary.tv reviews? And you know, it made sense. It was a great question to ask, because there are people out there that are doing this. And there are hundreds, probably thousands of wine apps out there. So why do you think that Gary's stands apart?
You know, I mean, content is king, right? And anybody can open up a Wine Spectator or anybody can open up these magazines, but really, where's the incentive? Because at the end of the day, they're pretentious, they're stuffy, and they're not fun. We want to make it fun, educational, and now at this point with the mobile play, useful.
Yeah.
We want to be with you when you're buying your wine so that we can help you walk you through the process. So that's really where we differentiate ourselves. One, we're with you on the go, and two, we're not boring. So I think that's kind of the last word anybody's going to describe Yuri's videos as, is boring.
No, they certainly aren't. They are not boring. So when you guys set out to do this, first of all, I get asked the question, and just because it's a month now, it's been about a month since you've released, I see the insane activity on the website on Daily Grape. Like, each episode maybe gets between 700 and 1,000 comments, which is an incredibly engaged audience, which is exactly what you need. But how many people have downloaded this thing for the iPhone?
It's a great question. And, you know, we were lucky on a couple of different fronts. One is the fact that we literally launched both the website and the app at South by Southwest. Yeah. And it was a big announcement during Gary's keynote. So right away we had an audience of about 2,500 people staring him in the face, a captive audience, when he told everybody, one, I'm retiring from Wine Library TV, and two, pull out your phone and download my app.
And you're not, I'm not letting you out the door until you download the app, right?
Exactly. So we were lucky in that regard, in that we kind of made a big announcement, made a splash right off the bat. And number two, we were also lucky enough that Apple has really been a big supporter of Gary's move to mobile. And they featured us in the App Store for about a week, just about 2 weeks after we were out.
Okay.
So now about a month in, we're just approaching 30,000 downloads.
That's
now.
Awesome.
Yeah, we're psyched. We're definitely psyched. Those two things, we couldn't have picked a better time.
No, you couldn't. And obviously Gary's book comes out at the same time. So there's a lot of momentum. He seems to be quite literally everywhere, which helps, obviously. But 30,000 downloads, you know, you put that in perspective to the, you know, when you make a piece of software like this, some people feel very privileged to have 100 people using it or 1,000 people using it. And in Canada, a gold book, I think a platinum level book is like 5,000 buys. And so when you start to think about 30,000 people engaging with this application, do you guys keep track of that, the amount of engagement or how many times people use it, that kind of stuff? Or is it, are you at that point?
At this point, I don't have analytics right off the bat, but I can tell you that, you know, the watch through rate for every video is, it's enormous. We're really lucky. We have not only, you know, are we getting the downloads, but the people that are using the product are truly using it and not just, you know, flipping it open and looking at it briefly. We have serious watch through rates, which it means a lot. I think that number speaks a lot more than the actual download. Sure, 30,000 is impressive.
Yeah.
But
how engaged they are.
Exactly. At the end of the day, that's really what you're going for.
So you talk about that. I mean, the two things, obviously, announcing it South by Southwest, 2,500 people in the audience, being featured on Apple App Store, which is a, you know, a beautiful thing, and momentum around Gary himself. But that still maybe accounts for a good portion of that. But there's still a community here. I mean, Gary had built that community leading up to the launch of this. So how important was that? Like, to have, you know, 1,000 episodes of Wine Library TV, an established community, people who watch and follow Gary's every move. When you launch this, you launch with a bump.
Definitely. I think that's really puts us in a unique position in that my job has been somewhat easy because I don't believe that at all. Maybe that's not fair, but
no.
I guess I was kind of blessed to be put into this role where Gary had already done a lot of the sweat equity to build up a community.
Yeah.
To take a product like Wine Library TV, and he did all the legwork to build up to the point where he had 90,000 daily viewers. So, yeah, it's been a hell of a ride, and he's put in an enormous amount of work. It didn't happen overnight to build up that community. So to then, you know, kind of rebrand and launch this new product, already having that type of viewership, it made it lucky for us. I won't lie to you there. It's made things easier than starting from the ground up.
Well, and that's, I mean, one of the big challenges, obviously, for any kind of mobile application is being findable, right? You know, you're in a sea of similar applications, and any audience that you've already collected, obviously, is what you have to leverage. But I think that now going forward, I think the big challenge is probably going to be expanding that, isn't it?
Definitely, definitely. And one thing you just hit on there is that you said, you know, there are so many apps out there like it. And Vintank, which is a wine and kind of social consulting agency out in California, just came out with an article, I think yesterday or the day before, where they were really reviewing the mobile space for wine specifically. There are more than 300 iPhone apps in the store right now that are wine specific.
Yeah,
I mean, that's pretty crazy in that, you know, 2 years ago, there were probably one or two.
Yep.
So the space has been flooded recently. So I think that you, at this point, it's really, you have to differentiate yourself, make sure that your product's worthy. And that's really what we're focused on doing.
Yeah. And I mean, wine is at 300, I mean, is small compared to, you know, the gaming community or the, you know, enterprise applications or all that kind of stuff. But it's still, you know, how do you break through? And it's a personality. I'm in Ottawa, and, there's an Ottawa woman here who put out an app called Nat Decants, and it's one of the premium wine applications, and it's here in the city. But I've talked to her about the challenges of you know, it's constant. You have to be, especially if it's a commodity, like a wine review is a commodity, because and it's an opinion. Everybody's got one. And the worst thing that you can be doing is standing in front of a wine and trying to figure out, you know, or trying to choose between two wines, and ultimately, you know, you do go to your mobile, you do go to recommendations like this, and
nice to be armed with more than just which label is prettier when it comes to making a decision, which in all seriousness is probably how 80% of the world shops, in addition to, you know, price, how a critic has scored it on a score of 0 to 100, but the label is a huge factor, which it shouldn't be. So
that's why Yellowtail is so popular. It sticks out, and that it might not be a good wine.
Exactly, exactly. Kudos to them for marketing.
Oh, yeah. Can we talk about the community that is being developed now that you've launched the application and you've got 30,000 users? What's been the response for the people who are actually using this application now?
You know, the response has definitely been positive. I will say this, we've definitely worked through some bug fixes. We've just put out version 1.02, which at this point we're just getting through all the different issues and things like that, which, you know, you're bound to have it at launch, especially which, you know, when you have a product that we didn't rush it out, but we definitely wanted to make sure that we had it ready for South by Southwest, and it was many months in the making, but I think everybody kind of runs into hurdles with little bug fixes that need to be made. But at this point, the community's been overwhelmingly, you know, positive. There were a few people who were a little skeptical at first because over the 5-year period of Wine Library TV, they'd gotten so comfortable with that format and really, you know, were a little afraid that Gary was going to jump the shark, as they might call it. But the community has really, really fallen in love with it. One thing that you actually mentioned earlier when we were talking is the fact that in the most recent episode, at the end, Gary asked people, you know, how are you watching the program? Are you watching it from your mobile phone? Are you watching it from the web? And we knew the number would be high for mobile, but I would say about 50% of the people said that they're now watching from their iPhone, which for us is, I mean, that's, We couldn't have dreamt of a better response. That means that what we're doing makes sense. So it's been a good response.
Why do you think that people are watching this or so compelled to watch this on a mobile device? Now, do you think it's a combination of the length of the episode or the experience in transit, or, you know, people are bored all the time? What do you think is driving it?
I think people are busy. I mean, you walk through the subway and what are people doing? They have their head buried in their phone.
Yeah.
People, you know, can't sit down for dinner together as a family because everybody's, you know, running around the town. They're busy. So really the only time that they might have to watch you is when they're in a cab on the way to their meeting, or when they're, you know, on the train, on their way to work, the last thing they have time for is to sit down, you know, at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and kick up their feet and throw on a long 40-minute program. Everybody's busy. So we definitely want to make sure that we steal their time, and their only free time is with their head buried in a phone. So luckily we're able to kind of fill that void for them.
All right. So simultaneous website launch at dailygrape.com, app launch on the iPhone. You know, a lot of people saying, hey, where's the Android? That's coming. Bug fixes, that's coming. It's to be expected, you know, in a new platform. Was there a big surprise that hit you when this thing went out? What was it that you know, kind of resonated with you guys that you said, oh, you know, we didn't have a clue that would happen?
That's a good question. You know, nothing kind of jumps out at me as something that we were kind of throwing a curveball with. Huh. It's been an interesting, you know, learning experience for all of us, though. As much as Gary's been involved with things like, you know, on the board of advisors for Gowalla, he's never actually taken a product and launched it himself in the mobile space. Yeah. I think what's been enormous is kind of seeing it evolve, even from the time that we kind of conceptualized the product, maybe, you know, close to a year ago at this point.
All right.
The idea has been a little over a year brewing now. So it's definitely been kind of a long time in the development stage.
So talk about that. Talk about that, you know, the original vision of the product versus mm-hmm. how it ended up. And then how did you refine that from where it was a year ago?
Yeah, it's, I think really we recognize that, you know, you walk through the city and you see everybody with their head buried in a phone. And it kind of wakes you up. It makes you realize this is kind of the move you have to make.
Yeah.
I think Gary knew that he wanted to have his product mobily, and luckily he was able to kind of move somewhat quickly. It did take a year, but for a guy as busy as he is, we were lucky to do it as quick as we did. Yeah. But definitely, really, at the end of the day, we want to make our content useful. And at the point where it was before, people had to dedicate a lot of time and they needed to commit to educate themselves. Now we're kind of in your pocket, short snippets of information that are useful on the go when you're buying wine.
It's really interesting because I look at Wine Library TV, and you know, there's a natural offshoot for a product in Wine Library TV because I mean, you're reviewing products. I mean, it makes sense, right? And there's probably an endless supply of that product mm-hmm. globally, wherever you go, in whatever store you end up in. So there is a product. There's always a product there. But the fact that it's a product with video, which makes it very unique. So you've taken the content and distilled it down. You didn't just take the old content. You rearranged it. You condensed Gary, which is, you know, very, very difficult to do sometimes, into these 5 and 10 minute chunks. You know, was that a part of the original plan, or was it just a wine app that you were gonna build a year ago?
Yeah, you know, I think a lot of the time what we were hearing from our users, and by the way, we definitely listened to them. Mm-hmm. I think people a lot of the time they think their comment might be lost in the comment section. But if you look, we're engaging and we're listening to people and we're listening to what they want. We would get emails and we would get comments from people that say, you know, hey, Gary, love the show, but at this point, you know, I just got back from vacation. I'm now 14 episodes behind and I just can't catch up. I don't have the time.
Yeah.
Because they were a half an hour each. And that was killing us, you know, to know that there were people out there who they just don't have their time in the day to commit to a 40-minute wine program.
It's true.
So, yeah, so the, like, kind of, I guess, the combination of listening to them and the fact that mobile was emerging, they both fell in line with each other. It just made sense to bring it to 5 to 10 episodes. That was really just the natural progression.
Yeah, I can understand the challenge of being 14 episodes down. And you know, I do this on Tether.tv. And my episodes are 30 or 40 minutes sometimes 60 minutes if I get lost in the conversation. And, you know, people come here to learn very specific things. And, you know, not everybody watches every episode. And if anybody's out there that's watched every episode, I'm so impressed. Please let me know who you are. I'll send you a mug. I'll send you an untether.tv mug if you've watched every episode. Or a case of them. Or a case of wine from Wine Library. So I expect people to watch one. Yeah. I expect people to watch one or two out of 5 or 10 episodes, what the preference is. So I can understand, you know, the challenge of bringing it down to a point where you can, it's digestible chunks and there's really great value and you can do it in a mobile space. And that is, as you said, it might not even be 10 minutes or 5 minutes. It might be 3 minutes, but I don't think you can get down that low, can you?
Nah, we try, but it won't happen.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that you took over from Wine Library TV was two wines, right? Like, why two wines? Why not just do one wine?
That's a great question. And it's, doing one wine is something we've kind of flirted with. Mm-hmm. And there have been a couple of episodes where, for whatever reason, the circumstance, we, you know, the second wine was bad or something like that, where we've only done one. But really, I think there's a point of comparison with wine where people want to see either one of the same style and compare them side by side in a showdown type of episode,
yeah,
or just kind of a point of comparison. And really trying to do one wine, it wouldn't get accomplished that. And doing three wines is just a little too much to pack into a condensed down version of the show.
Sure.
You know, with Wine Library TV, he would sometimes do as many as 5 or 6 wines. But it really, this format, it just doesn't serve its purpose.
Yeah, but why not? So what about, even with the 5 or 6 wines in Wine Library TV, why not just condense it, like, do a little bit of editing around it? Because I know there's no editing that goes on, right, right now. It's just, like, straight up, that's what you get, right?
Definitely. And that's really been kind of something that Gary's a gun that he wants to stick to, and that it's raw. We want to be, you know, as transparent, as straightforward, as raw as kind of as you can be. And, well, you know, we're definitely all for great production and you know, adding the benefit of a lapel mic, which we've started using for daily. We want to maximize production, but we also don't want to turn to editing in order to kind of chop things out. We'd rather just be, you know, kind of shoot for that 5 to 10 minutes and go for it.
Well, that's what it is. I mean, especially with having a Gary on the mobile. Basically, it's like he's in your ear, right? And he's having like a conversation. Like, I read Crush It. And then I listened to Crush It, you know, in an audiobook. And there is a drastic difference from my voice reading Gary's words to his voice telling me what he meant by those words and going off topic. And you know, it was that ad-libbing that really made the difference. And that's probably why I watch a show, you know, of a topic that I'm not really interested in, but I'm getting more and more interested in. Damn him, right?
Definitely. Yeah, he's charismatic, but he also brings kind of, you know, the people enjoy the ad lib. They want to hear just a little bit of Jets talk, just a little bit of pop culture, which, oh, by the way, one thing I didn't mention is the fact that it truly is a daily show.
Yeah.
In that, you know, we're recording it within 24 hours of its eventual post date. Which is somewhat different than Wine Library TV, where often we'd find ourselves recording episodes, you know, 3 or 4 days in advance.
Yeah.
And pushing them out throughout the course of the week. This, we really want to have that, you know, where is Gary today? What is he doing? Yeah. Kind of, you know, put people on the road with him. You know, if he just filmed an episode about an hour ago in Norway, and yeah, we're going to publish it in about an hour. So that's really kind of cool to be able to you know, travel along with him. And it almost adds a dynamic of where is he now? So
I think it's great. And I also subscribe to this whole thing about, you know, getting content up as quickly as you can that's relevant. And you don't want to, you know, I don't like editing either. So it's a big challenge because people like to edit out the things, the dumb things that they say, but it's part of humanity, right? It's your humanity.
Exactly.
So when you look at this property that you've got a guy like Gary who has a phenomenal following, and he has a following in multiple aspects of his life, right? So he's got the guys who read his books, and he's got the brands that he works with VaynerMedia, which are huge brands. And then he's got his wine library followers, his wine followers. How do you match that? Like, I mean, how do you get some crossover in what he's doing in the mobile space with that audience? You know, or are you trying to do that, or are you just trying to introduce it to new people?
Definitely, definitely. And it's almost been like the perfect storm in that, the wine world was kind of waiting for somebody like Gary to come along. And the reason I say that is if you look at the trends that are emerging, you know, 10 years ago, the only people drinking wine were 50 and 60 year old white dudes, to be quite frank. At this point, it's amazing the way that the wine culture is shifting. And in many ways, you know, I don't want to give him too much credit, but I'd like to think that Gary is kind of inspiring that shift.
Sure.
And at the very least, that he's operating, you know, in collaboration with the shift, and that he's helping it. You know, you look at trends that come out. Nielsen just came out with some studies recently about, one, smartphones and who's using them.
Yeah.
Well, they're Generation X, Generation Y, and millennials, whatever term you want to use for it. And then you look at where the growth is within the wine market, and it's young people. It's, you know, the largest market of wine buyers at this point are people my age in their late 20s and early 30s. Those are the ones that are driving the market, and they have a newfound interest in wine. Whereas before it was, you know, beer and vodka 10 years ago.
Yeah.
So I definitely see that's really where the market's going. And he, you know, his Thank You Economy readers, the people that he knows from, you know, the social space, they're finding an interest in wine, whether it be because of Gary or just because that's where the world's going.
Well, yeah, especially you. I think you brought it up early on, which was that you know, he's out there advising his clientele to leverage this great technology in mobile and start to bring it into their business. And you know, it's not the next web; it's a new piece of technology. It's a new paradigm. And then looking at his inventory, he's like, well, you know what? I was pretty far ahead when it came to you know, video on the web, e-commerce, and doing transactions online and buying wine online, but lacking in the mobile space. So I think this is like he had to obviously do this in order to be able to say that, look, yeah, I'm doing it and I'm experimenting with these things and I'm coming up with new business models, and ultimately that can help them everywhere. Wouldn't you say? Is that
absolutely? You know, I sometimes hate these studies that come out by all these different companies, because I think, one, they're often over, you know, inflated, and two, you hate to just rely on the numbers to kind of validate what you're doing. But I recently read a study that said of smartphone, you know, users, the average person is watching 80 minutes of video every week on their phone, which you hear numbers like that and they're hard to ignore. So to not be in the video in mobile form when you have a daily video program, it was just a necessary step.
Absolutely. And, you know, mobile advocate, obviously, and I watch a lot of entrepreneurs trying to struggle with the business model of what it is that they're trying to do. You know, some people, there's so many different business models in mobile, and some, you know, have just been invented. Some are just rehashing old business models, and some have yet to be invented. You know, so when you look at what you're doing with DailyGrape, is the community development the most important piece of this, or is education on wine the most important piece, or is it about, Gary said it himself, he said, look, you know, Pierce, I'm a businessman. First and foremost, I'm a businessman. Where's the business in this?
That's an awesome question. And that, for, I guess, first and foremost, I should preface it with, you know, building the community is number one, and having the community there is our number one goal. And, you know, that's been Gary's MO from day one, is, you know, to give a crap about your end user, which he, you know, his belief is that most businesses don't. They're truly in it to make a buck. You know, and that's it. But really, the business model lies in fostering that community and then offering them the opportunity to get more of Gary, which comes in the form of a monthly newsletter. So what that will have are, you know, a couple hundred additional wine reviews every month. So the wines that he's tasting off camera, we'll have written tasting notes and descriptions of each of those wines. Also have additional video content, which, rather than being wine reviews, they'll be kind of broad general assessments of trends within the industry.
Okay.
So whether it be talking about up and coming regions that Gary's starting to discover and thinks are, you know, worthy of checking out, or whether it be talking about you know, very industry specific topics that might appeal to professionals and other people that work within the wine business. So we'll offer basically both additional video and written content, extra Gary.
And that's only in an email format. So that's not part of the so much part of the app as it is just like you subscribe to that and you can do that on the website, right?
Exactly. Yeah. It's you'll get email notification, but the actual newsletter itself will be behind a paywall on the website.
Yeah. I mean, I think that that's there's so many different ways I think that you can take this content and Gary's knowledge of this content and make some generate some revenue from this. Obviously, you know, there's a thousand ideas come to mind, but you know, one of the questions that just dawned on me as you were talking about this is that you're building this community, and you know, Gary's line from Thank You Economy is you know you give a crap, right? You got to give a crap. And so how is it that and this is a big challenge? How do you give a crap about 30,000 people that are using this application? Like, that's a big number to say. Listen, you know what? A little piece of me, right? How can you give a crap about 30,000 people that are downloading this application?
It's, you know, it's tough, and you know, one person, it's tough to scale, right? That's kind of
yep.
The other thing that I guess Gary's always said is that he's spread thin.
Yes.
But really, it's been an interesting kind of progression since transitioning from Wine Library TV into this new space. In that, you know, I wouldn't say that Gary becomes stale or that he completely ignored Wine Library TV, and that it was kind of, you know, it's not that he was just going through the emotion, going through the motions and doing it because he'd done it for so long.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, there was a fire that wasn't maybe burning as bright as it had been in the early years, and that's definitely kind of changed, and you've seen like he's really got that passion back, which has been fun to see with DailyGrape. You know, he spends every free minute of his day engaging with that community, whether it be, you know, in the comments section of DailyGrape, on Twitter, on Facebook, wherever the people are, you know, engaging with him and reaching out to him, he wants to be. So between the two of us, we're definitely hitting on our community and kind of.
It's a daunting task, nonetheless, right? I mean, because I often talk to entrepreneurs who say, you know, God, I wish I had 1 million downloads. And I say, well, you know what? Go easy a little bit, because 1 million downloads sets a level of expectation. And something like somebody like Gary, who set that level of expectation so great, you know, you don't want 1 million downloads, because everyone will want a piece of it, right? So
exactly. And, you know, it makes sense. I think you need to grow within your means and kind of make sure that you're in a position to get those 1 million downloads overnight if you really want that.
It's part of building the community. Now, let me ask you, John, I mean, your background in this, not from the technology side, not from the mobile side, but really from the wine side, is that's where you come from?
Exactly. Yeah. I was, I grew up in the restaurant industry originally, so I've always kind of had a love for food and wine.
Yeah.
And then I went to business school, and you know, all the while I was going to business school, and I didn't know what industry I specifically wanted to get into.
So you love, just let me interrupt here for a second. So you love food and wine, and you go into business school, and you're out there looking for a career in a business that deals with wine.
Yeah, well, at the time when I was in business school, I wasn't completely set on you know, finding something within the wine industry.
Yeah.
But that was the kind of my one true love at the end of the day. So I was lucky to find, you know, that person, which is Gary. And then
how did you find him?
I met him a few years ago at the Boston Wine Expo, which is kind of the largest wine expo in the US every year. And I just kind of bit his ear and wouldn't let him go, and said, you know, if any opportunities come up, please let me know, keep me in mind. And then originally about a little over 2 years ago at this point, I came on board Corked, which was another, you know, wine online project that Gary got his hands involved with, a wine social network.
Wine social network.
Just about 6 months ago, so at this point, we just kind of transitioned my role into green.
I mean, it's great. And then are you tasked with coming up with the business models for this, or is the business model set? Are you guys, you don't take any advertising dollars for this, but do you have ideas about how this app can generate revenue?
Definitely. And, you know, I would be lying to tell you that, you know, advertising is something that we're not considering, because it definitely is very real. It's we want to do it in a very tactful and fair way, and we don't want to compromise, you know, the content or the product at the end of the day. But kind of separating DailyGrape from any retail affiliation, we're no longer, you know, we don't work out of Wine Library, we don't have any affiliation with his family's business, has definitely given us the option of being able to do pre-roll advertising for episodes and kind of things of that nature. So there are other streams of revenue that we're willing to pursue.
Yeah, I mean, even commerce, right? So you could buy wine through the device or through the app. Is that something that you've looked at as well?
You know, it is, but it might be something longer term. At this point, being, you know, kind of filling the shoes of a wine critic, you can't be selling the product either just because of the conflict of interest. So at this point, we really don't have any intentions of selling wine. But it's really a focus on the subscription base and potential ad based revenue.
So let's talk about a little bit about future thinking around what kind of services things are you planning on rolling out for this thing? So I mean, I know it's only a month in, but you've been thinking about it for a year. The curse of the entrepreneur is that you always think so big, and somebody has to be there saying, okay, well, let's just get this done, which is the tip. What else is coming down the road for what you guys are doing with DailyGrape?
Awesome question. Couple things. One, and you mentioned it earlier, and it's natural, you know, everybody kind of knows it's coming, but the Android app is something that we're really focused on getting out there. Hopefully 6 to 8 weeks is what people should expect. But you hate to set that precedent and not be able to, you know, we don't want to overpromise and underdeliver. So that's kind of new and exciting. Definitely have plans to incorporate, you know, GPS technology, in that we want to be able to help people make the app useful. So if you find a wine that Gary's tasted and he gives it, you know, a high score, and you add it to your wish list, to be able to get push notification that wine is available within a certain distance is kind of something that we see coming down the road. And then finally, for newsletter subscribers exclusively, we're going to put together some different deals and offers. That'll be announced every month with the newsletter. So whether it be discounts on wine accessories or chances to win a trip to you know, wine country, things like that, which should be brewing and should be out very soon.
See, that's really interesting when you start to think like the daily deals, but in wine, right? So monthly deals for DailyGrape. Yeah, you know, those kind of things are really interesting, especially the location, because location for me, you know, I did a great session here on Untether with broadcaster.com, which is an audio tour. Basically, they say, you know, they put an audio layer on life. So you stamp it with a location, and, you know, somebody talks into, you know, you talk into your phone and you record your thoughts at that moment. Mm-hmm. I think, boy, would it ever be very cool to get a vineyard tour, you know, done by Gary, or a tour of a, you know, a liquor store, or, you know, something that when I walk in, I can get the daily, like, okay, buy this wine, you know, stamped based on location, something like that really does incorporate, you know, the ability to get a quick wine review out and location. You know, so there's so many things you can think of, just with, when you've got this device in your hand. I guess the key is to focus on the things that are right in front of you and get those done properly.
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, I know I sound like a broken record here, but we want to make, you know, the product as useful as possible. Yeah. And if you know that a wine that you might like is within, you know, a 3 mile radius of you, and that you can easily access that wine, that's pretty darn useful. So, you know, we're excited about some things to come.
Last question here, Jon, just, it might be a little bit of a long one. Not for me, but your answer, hopefully. Marketing tactics that you guys have used. So you've got Gary, which is a marketing tactic, mm-hmm. a pretty big one. But you've got you as well, who are in the trenches, working the community, building this up. What kind of advice can you give to somebody who's building an application like similar to this, which is basically an entertainment application? I'd label it under that, but it's edutainment, perhaps. So what kind of advice would you have somebody who's trying to market this thing without a Gary Vaynerchuk associated with it?
Yeah.
Go find one?
Yeah, exactly. Go pay Michael Jordan to endorse your product.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, not that easy. You know, 5 or 6 years ago, if you, you know, you asked somebody who was in the tech space at that point if they knew who Gary was, they wouldn't have a clue. Right. And really, at the end of the day, why people know who Gary is at this point, it's because he, you know, stayed up until 4 a.m. every day, and he, you know, sent out emails and caught up with everybody who had any type of interest in wine. He cared about his customer, and he really, you know, he put in the extra work. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really what it takes at this point, because the world is so competitive at this point that if you want to be the best app in your space, you need to stay up every night till 4 a.m. or else you're not going to be the number one. You're not going to be the number one download. You're not going to get those million downloads that you talk about. You know, it's just very competitive. People have high expectations, and it takes the work. And I know that's not the long answer you were looking for, but I think really that's what it is. Really, at the end of the day, it's just giving
hard work. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I agree. You know, I mean, I read Tim Ferriss's 4-Hour Work Week, and then I balance that with Crush It, and somewhere in the between the two is what a normal human can do or should do, right? Yeah. Because you've got two extremes there.
Don't get me wrong, I enjoy a glass of wine every Friday night or so. I do kick my feet up every now and then, but finding that balance and making sure you're putting in the hard work is all it takes.
Well, yeah, I said that was going to be the last question, but something dawned on me a little bit more about staying up so late and interacting with your customer base creates a brand around you, and Gary's created that brand around him, and it's kind of, you know, lent itself very well, along with an insane amount of knowledge in his industry, which is one of the key things, right? He's not out there shucking, he's out there educating, which is a big difference. You know, he's not selling, he's educating. When you look at what DailyGrape has accumulated as a brand, how can you take it to another level? How can you find those other customers? Where do you have to be in order to be able to get, you know, 40,000, 50,000 downloads, if that's what you guys are trying to do, or engage with 10 or 20,000 more people?
That's an awesome question. And I think it comes out of a couple of different things, in that one, even though, you know, the smartphone and the you know, the iTunes store and, you know, the Android marketplace and all these things, they're already big markets, but we're lucky enough to know and to see the forecasts, and that people are, you know, we've only begun to crack the amount of people who eventually will have smartphones.
Oh, yeah.
So those people are going to come eventually. But number two, I think the other thing is that, you know, kind of leading people to the well, in that, you know, showing them the wine is something to be enjoyed, and that it's not just for those 50 and 60 year old white guys who were drinking it 10 years ago, and that making them understand that it's something that's for the masses, and that you can find pretty good stuff at an affordable price. You know, kind of leading them to the well is a huge thing too. So we really want to make sure that we drive home both of those things.
Yeah. So, you know, great lesson, creating value, offering something of absolute value to an audience, making it, actually bringing it down to a pedestrian level, which is, so, you know, normal people can understand what it means to taste, you know, pencil shavings or eraser, as you said, or dirt or a sock, a gym sock or whatever it is. Maybe not normal people.
Yeah.
I don't chew on a gym sock. But that language and the incredible amount of knowledge and the amount of effort really does lend itself well to taking what that and putting it into a mobile application, taking an existing brand and bringing it over. And then it's about curating that community and making sure that they stay engaged. And really, that's where, I mean, you dive in there, don't you?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. It's been fun. It's, you know, anybody who's flirting with the idea of, you know, taking their product and going mobile, I guess I would say, one, now is the time. You know, don't wait, because, you know, there's another guy who's not far away from you who probably has a similar idea, and he's going to capitalize if you don't. Number two, just go for it. That's really what it is.
Totally agree. I mean, mobile is a paradigm shift, and I think that, you know, people who are going to embrace this, they get it. They're working on it, but it does take effort. You're not going to turn it on and get a million downloads without a whole lot of sweat, a lot of effort. And we've seen that with what you guys are doing with DailyGrape. So, John, thank you so much for doing this. I really appreciate your time. Very, very patient with the questions. We've had some lag in the technology, but it hasn't stopped the conversation. Where can people find out more about what you guys are up to?
Great question. So one, they can go to the iTunes store, do a quick search of Daily Grape, and you'll be able to find the app. Number two, if you're still on the web, DailyGrape.com. You can find us and you know, get all your daily wine fix. So either of those two places.
I love that. If you're still on the web, that's great.
And Twitter. Yeah. Of course, Twitter and Facebook. You can find us too. Quick search of Daily Grape and we're not to be missed.
Listen, that's great. I've been speaking with Jon Troutman, who is the Director of Operations for DailyGrape.com. Also, go download Daily Grape, the application, found in iTunes. If you just type in Daily Grape somewhere, you're going to find something that has to do with this, and go and do it. Thank you, John. Thank you guys for listening. Thank you guys for watching. I really appreciate the fact that you made it through another episode of Untether.tv. There's a whole bunch more in the archive. Go and watch, go and listen, go and learn. That's been another episode. Thank you guys so much.